We're at the wonderful Jolly Pumpkin restaurant and the Mission Table, having a beer and a conversation with my good friend and partner, Dr. Steve Thomas, and talking a little bit about plastic surgery in Northern Michigan and our practice and getting some historical perspective and just having a great time. And thought you'd be interested in some of his insights over 25, how many years?
26.
26 years of practice. He's seen a lot of changes and people are interested in plastic surgery so much, we may as well talk a bit about it.
Yeah, I'm old, might as well talk about the history of it. So I've seen a lot of it.
And we're here with Trevor O'Brien too, who's our newest partner and a terrific addition to the Center for Plastic Surgery and helping us so much with our mission. We're expanding services, we're getting better at stuff, and Dr. Thomas has really led the way. So it's fun to sit down and talk once in a while about different things that you've seen and procedures that you do, and you've taught me so much. I wanted to get this on camera, on film, and be able to refer back to it. It's been an awesome learning experience.
Before you put me out to the pasture.
And yeah, something like that.
So, well, the good part is we got a perspective too, because we've got me, the old guy, you, the middle guy, and the young guy. So we can see the difference between.
Yeah, so we might all chime in. I have some questions for you. I want to ask you some probing questions so you can tell us more about plastic surgery in Northern Michigan and Traverse City in particular.
Okay.
One of those has to do with patient relationships. And I'm fascinated about how you've been able to ingratiate yourself, get to know this community, serve the community, but develop relationships here. I think that's a real lesson for surgeons and physicians throughout the region, and I've been continually impressed every year by your ability to do that. And I'm curious to know what makes that go. How have you done that in this town?
Well, I think it was interesting because I fit. I think it was a nice fit for me when I came here, from the standpoint of I didn't really fit into a big city. As you know, I grew up in a little tiny town, and me going to a big city was probably not going to be rewarding for me in the long run. However, as plastic surgeons, we have a certain population that we have to use to support us. It's not like we can just have a 10,000 population city and say, yeah, we're here, we're parked, we're gonna make a living. So I think it was a good fit, and kind of to me, the people resonated with me. They were my people. And I can tell you though, the interesting thing about Traverse City, and I think I mentioned it to Trevor when he joined on, and I might even mention it to you too, is that you have to be careful in Traverse City because you might have a very wealthy person walk in and a pair of jeans and a flannel shirt, and you never know who it is. And it could be famous, it could be from Traverse City, they could be from anywhere. And it's kind of a low-key city. And I think kind of situationally for me, that fit well with me.
And you've had famous people come. You've told me these stories. You've had famous people without naming names. So you've had people come from far away to come here for what you provided and what the office offered.
I think the furthest one so far for me is Nova Scotia. I had a patient from Nova Scotia.
That's good. I thought Dallas. Okay.
I've had Dallas. I've had Nova Scotia. Nova Scotia was the furthest one away. And that came about a friend of a patient who actually became a friend. So I've become friends with a lot of my patients. A patient of mine was on a cruise, and on the cruise met this other woman, and during the cruise she says, oh yeah, by the way, I've had a facelift. She says, well, who did your facelift? Because it's lovely, I love it. And she told her, and they said, okay, I'm in. I get a call, they come in from Nova Scotia, they stayed for 2 weeks, I did the facelift, and they were happy.
It's wild. There's nothing bad about being complimentary.
No.
To patients, you know?
No.
I think that's just such a thing about plastic surgery. I compliment a lot of people's work a lot of the time. You ever seen that? Where you have a nice patient in the office who's had something done and they expect you to say, oh no, here's what I'd do differently. But it's so much more fun when you can say, no, this is really beautiful. I think you have a fantastic result.
Definitely.
You ever seen that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And I think too, the other part about the whole situation up here is that the patients appreciate up here hard work and work well done. They do like that for the most part. I mean, most of the time, if you can talk to a person up here and you can explain to them what they want and break it down into smaller terms, because they know they need plastic surgery, but they don't know what it is, and they see it on TV, they see it in magazines. But if you can say, okay, let's talk about the garage door openers in your eyes, and you break it down into an analogy, they go, oh, I get it now. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so here's a question. So why do these people come from far away? Tell me about something you've come up with. Are there any surgical innovations? I mean, really coming down to surgery that you thought, hey, this is a good idea, and it's something that's worked for you over the years. Teach me about something that you think you brought to the table.
I think most of the things that I've brought to the table have been, I hate to say it, but you know, sometimes it's through things you go, I don't like how that turned out. And so you say, I'm not doing that anymore. It doesn't look, that's what they say.
It's not like on TV, it's not how plastic surgery works. Sometimes things, you have to tweak.
And you look at it and you say, I don't like that, let's fix it. But when you do it twice, it's silly to keep going back to the well that didn't work the first time or the second time. So you start to look back at it and you go, that does not work. I'm not doing that anymore, you know? And I started to look at, I think the thing that I probably have honed the best is breast reduction. And they taught me to do a breast reduction as a resident. When they taught me the reduction, just like you guys, they give you the pattern, and they say, yeah, this is the pattern you draw, you go do the reduction, and this is how you make it happen. The problem is that not everybody fits the pattern. And so I think that over the years, I think that I've become better at looking at it and saying, the pattern doesn't work for all people. You have to shift the pattern or change a pattern from A to B and B to C. Mm-hmm. And I have done a lot of breast reductions. Some of the things that I think I do in the breast reduction, the way that we prepare the tissues to sew them back together again. And I like sewing the breast reduction pedicle to the chest wall. I think it keeps the breast a little more perky over time. And everybody comes in and says, I want a breast reduction because my back hurts, my shoulders hurt, my neck hurt. And then they always say, oh, and I want to be perky too. Well, we don't want to do a breast reduction without making them perky. And I know some people say that doesn't work very well, but I think it does. And I do put a lot of stitches. I do sew the pedicle to the chest wall.
I remember one time you told me, you said, I had an interesting day, I had a cool day, I had three breast reductions. And this is the most common procedure we do, I'd say. Right? I mean, we probably do a couple hundred a year. Mm-hmm. So people think, oh, no, that's pretty rare. No, it's extremely common. I remember one day he said, I did three breast reductions today, each different technique, which is rare because you used to just do a cookie cutter thing. And so the trick here is being introspective about what you're seeing after the fact, remembering how you did it, and then modifying the technique to maximize the result. And I think that's really impressive. You probably told me that 6 years ago.
Yeah, I did.
I think something like that.
And not only that, I saw them all on the same day postoperatively too, which was fantastic because I got to see the changes that happened.
Oh, and compare the
three different techniques. Yeah. But again, you know, if you had a resident there that day, you should have had 100 residents there that day, because you could have said, okay, I know that they showed you this pattern. I know that this is what they told you to do, but look at, here's three different patients and three totally different techniques.
I was going to say, that's one operation where, just like Steve, I was taught a certain way to do it, and I've, after discussion with you and seeing how you do things, I've pretty much totally redone the way I do a breast reduction now because of what you've taught me. And you know, having you around my first couple of years of practice, and you as well, but you know, you guys' experience has really been beneficial to me, you know, starting in practice. So, you know, I know as you get ready to phase out, it's a big change in your life, but you know, you've had a big impact on my life as well. So
yeah,
it's a big shift for me too.
Well, not only that, but I keep trying to tell you guys, no, don't do that. That's not going to work.
this is an offshoot question. Is there anything that you do exactly the same as when you trained? Exactly how you trained to do it with no modification?
I can only think of one thing. Right off the top of my head, one thing. Upper eyelid surgery, blepharoplasty. I was trained a little different than a lot of people. I was trained to put the incision in the canthus in the corner of the eye. And I know a lot of people are trained to bring it up higher and take a look. I do it exactly the same way I was taught.
Interesting.
Yeah, it works. Not failed me. I still measure it the same way and mark it out the same way, and I have to wear glasses to do it now.
Yeah, right. So it's not exactly the same.
Not
fair
exactly.
Enough. Okay, when I got here 12 years ago, we were purely surgical. We did things like facelifts, breast surgery. What about non-surgical techniques? Have we brought about in the practice? What have you seen that has augmented or improved our practice? Such as things like Botox or neuromodulators, fillers, laser therapies. I mean, how much does that change what we do?
Oh, that's massive. You know, the biggest thing is that I think it's really changed the way that all plastic surgeons practice. And you and I have talked about this quite a bit in the past, about when I first came into practice, if you'd have said to a plastic surgeon, I want to buy your charts, and I want to meet all those other patients, they'd have said, well, that's insane. They're done. They've had their surgery. In the modern era, that's not how this works, because we are so invested now into pre-surgical treatment, in other words, trying to avoid surgery, and to maintenance after surgery, that we would never just get rid of those patients. We want those patients. We want to maintain them. We want to make sure that their results last for a long time. And it's making the consults when you first meet a patient extremely difficult. The way you approach it is even more advanced than when I came in. I was a baby when I came in. I didn't know anything about any of this other stuff. I had to go back and learn neuromodulators. They were just coming out in the cave era when I came out. But when you do a consult now, people believe that you're coming to the plastic surgeon to have surgery. And I think you're coming to the plastic surgeon to see, I have a problem, what are the options for the problem? And I believe that we've really become good at saying, okay, here's our non-surgical realm, here's our surgical realm, here's carte blanche, which may include a little of both, and here's what we're gonna do to get you ready for surgery, here's what we're gonna do after surgery, and we're gonna maintain you. And all of those things that are around there are those neuromodulators and the fillers and the lasers and everything else like that. It's made harder for us to do a consultation, but better for the patients. They get a bigger picture. Mm-hmm. They get a massive treatment that is maybe not surgical at all, but is gonna achieve the things that they want. So I think that one of the biggest fallacies I see in patients is that you'll talk to them and they'll say, oh, I had this done at the office by somebody else at a different office, and why'd you go there? Well, because they weren't a surgeon and I didn't want to have surgery, but now I'm here. And I said, yes, because that failed, but maybe you needed surgery in the first place. And so many times we can do things that we have, you know, like the new body tight device. I love that thing.
Yeah, there's a flip side to that. I saw somebody today who said about neck, you know, if you pull that up. I really looked at it and I thought, you know, I think I could do a neck lift, but the minimally invasive technique, I think in your case is actually better. Yeah. At your age, at your skin situation, there are situations where I think that the minimally invasive technique is better than what we'd offer surgically. And that doesn't mean that down the road we don't have something else, but that's always been the case, I think, in plastic surgery, going back to the early 1900s. I mean, the plastic surgeons have techniques and training to be able to offer really high-level treatments, but the judgment to offer the proper treatment at all times.
Exactly right.
And so that's been augmented by great technology.
Mm-hmm. Which is really cool about what you guys have built with the practice is we have the full gamut. We have the non-invasive, cool sculpting, cool tone, all the way up to the maximally invasive facelift, tummy tuck, surgery, and everything in between. So we're able to tailor a treatment to a patient, and we're not just, you know, we don't just have one hammer and everything's right. A nail.
You said about the body tight, so that's been an interesting one. What do you think? I mean, of all the things we've got, we have all these different devices and techniques, and we've tried them, and some have worked better than others. What do you think is the one that's been the best innovation?
There's been so many really good innovations. I think neuromodulators have changed the whole thing, because there's hardly anybody that...
And is that like, that's like Botox is the generic, but there are a lot of different types now. Yeah, and those have been great partners.
Yeah, and I think that if you really look at, especially facial cosmetic surgery, if you look at facial cosmetic surgery patients, there's hardly one that we do that can't have that or shouldn't have that, or is not having it. They should be engaged in
it. And it's for basically wrinkles that happen when you animate, when you raise your brow, that sort of thing, yeah.
Yeah, and you can go too much that way too. And that's what I've seen. Like everything in life, if 10's good, 100's better, you know? And then we end up with like one of these movie stars that can't smile, they don't move, and they look like a pasty, you know, porcelain doll.
But the concept of brow lift, you're talking particularly for the forehead area, the concept of a big brow lift, I haven't offered that to somebody in so long. It's something where they prefer an episodic treatment such as a neuromodulator. Botox, Dysport, Xeomin are the ones that we typically use. It's frankly better. That's a case of a smaller treatment than a surgical treatment. I've been very happy to offer that instead because I think it's better for the patient.
Well, and then when they do need it, the brow lift that I was taught, the big over the top, let's...
Yeah, a big scar on the hairline.
Yeah, nobody wants to talk about it, right? I mean, you brought these little incision things and I said, that's spectacular. So, I mean, I don't remember the last time I've done a coronal brow lift. It's been a long, long time, many years, over 5 years at least.
Huh. Interesting. I got another good question for you, and this is going to catch you off guard. But for the audience anyway, they may not know that you were professionally trained for almost a year in microsurgery. And if you want to maybe describe what microsurgery is, but since we don't do as much of that anymore, I'm interested to know how you think your training in microsurgery, which was really in its infancy when you did that fellowship.
Yeah,
that was new. It was new enough that not everybody could do that, and nobody in Traverse City could do that. So tell me about how microsurgery influenced your abilities in cosmetic surgery.
Well, I'm a firm believer that all of the surgeries that are not cosmetic help you be a better cosmetic surgeon. Because if you think about it, when we do things that are not cosmetic, we don't get to pick and choose where we want to make incisions often. They're made, the laceration's there, the burn's there, you know, the damage is done, the bone's broken. We don't get to pick and choose where we want to make those incisions. It definitely makes us better at making incisions and fixing things so that when we do cosmetic surgery where we can pick and choose, we can pick and choose where we make them so they're hidden as much as possible. Microsurgery is tough. Microsurgery is taking tissue from one part of your body, along with its blood vessels, moving it to an entirely different spot in your body, connecting the artery to the artery, the vein to the vein. They're often very small, as you know. You have to do it in a microscope. We've all done it together. It's spectacular surgery. It's wonderful, extremely time-consuming. And I think that's the thing that I would point out. I think that in microsurgery, successful microsurgery is preparation and patience. Because I think the one thing that happens in microsurgery, those cases, as you know, are 6, 7, 12-hour cases. They're a long time. And I think there is this push to get it done as quick as possible. I believe that what happens is when you're doing microsurgery, you're always going to get into that situation where you go, okay, I'm going to go faster here because I can. And when you do that, that's when an error occurs. That's when you go, oh, I wish I wouldn't have done that. And you have to go back and redo it and start over again. I think that's the problem. I think if you have patience and you go really slow, microsurgery has taught me to plod just a little bit. There are times when we speed up and there are times when we really slow down. We get around the facial nerves in a facelift, we go, room noise goes way down, we slow down. We go very carefully. We're in tiger country. Mm-hmm. I think microsurgery is patience. You have to say, stop, I can't get frustrated right now. I'm gonna slow down. Mm-hmm. And I think in cosmetic surgery, if you don't get frustrated and you're very patient, it's gonna come out right.
That's a good answer. It's hard to do. Yeah. You know, it's hard to do, to settle yourself down when something goes not quite how you expect and then bring it back to earth because you know you have to give the result. Right. And it has to turn out.
It would be nice if every facial nerve was in the same spot, if every platysma was in the right spot and looked exactly like everybody else's, but it doesn't. Mm-hmm. And so when we get there, we go, oh, this is different and not what I expected and not the usual. Patients think it's just status quo. Mm-hmm. We cut the skin, the thing is there, we fix it, we take care of it, but not everybody's the same. They're all a little bit different. Mm-hmm. So.
Okay, last question for this session. I'm curious to know, what do you think is the best for, let's say you do a tough case like that, 6, 8, 10 hours case, what's the best music to play? You play what on your playlist?
Well, I'm positive it's not techno pop rock.
Oh, that's
yeah.
That's
I'll
a
go crazy
trouble.
On that one. Oh, yeah. Not opera. I would say easy country, but not twangy easy country.
Chris Stapleton.
Yeah, I like Chris. Yeah, Chris Stapleton's
who's
good.
That?
Yeah, you know he is.
No, I don't.
Sorry.
I don't.
Chris Stapleton radio on Pandora would be fantastic. So.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, what about you?
I go through a progression. You know, if I do 5 cases in a day, I have a standard progression. I do, well, not always standard. It does change, but old blues, I like Chicago Electric Blues. I transition to blues rock like a Black Keys. I'll sometimes throw in a reggae station. I'll do an AC/DC if it were getting a little behind and, you know, just a little bit fatigued. And then I'll even do a little bit of I like a Sinatra or something like that. But my favorite is old blues, Chicago Electric Blues, and even some Delta blues like Robert Johnson.
You know, it's an interesting thing because that's a good way to start, because you know you're starting in a case that's going to take 7 hours, and you're like, oh, this is going to be a long case.
Yeah, some of the Aura staff used to hate it, though.
Go ahead.
I would say mine ebbs and flows based on the part of the case I'm doing or what type of surgery I'm doing. If it's, you know, liposuction or closing music, it's dubstep primarily, EDM.
Yeah.
If it's a facelift or something or a free flap or I want to take my time. And
what's that Christmas music you listen to? I like that one.
Christmas Trap?
Oh, yeah. That's fantastic. Yes. I do like
that's
that.
That's good stuff.
I listen to that at home, too.
Well, yeah. I got to tell you, I really appreciate you all tuning in. This is really fun for us, is to kind of hang out with Dr. Thomas, get some impressions of his perspective on the practice, perspective on plastic surgery in Traverse City, where we're going from here, frankly. And hopefully we're going to bring you some more episodes. And if you've enjoyed this, please let us know. Come by the office or give us a call. And cheers, and thank you for tuning in. Again, out to the wonderful Mission Table and Jolly Pumpkin Restaurant in Old Mission Peninsula. Cheers, and thank you for your hospitality. Thank you.